Well, I'd like to welcome you back again to the Barnabas study here, and we're going to pick up where we left off from our last time, and this is going to be part two of the overview of the book of Acts. And before we enter into this study, I would again just like to pray and just ask the Lord to touch our hearts and our minds as we open ourselves up to the Word of the Lord. And if you're there and you feel like you would like to pray as well, then join me in prayer to just ask the Lord to help us here in our time together. Lord, we're thankful, God, for your goodness and your grace that you have extended to our lives. And certainly, Lord, today, God, you have protected us. You've overshadowed us. And I pray, God, that for the next little while that your word would stimulate our hearts. And our minds, God, would be engaged, Lord, with you, because we do believe, Lord, that this is a profitable spiritual experience. And I pray, Lord, that somehow, God, that uniquely, that you would speak, Lord, to each of us individually and would help us to understand our responsibility in keeping our hearts and our lives and our minds clean and pure. And that, Lord, that we would be, Lord, wise disciples, Lord, for your cause. And I pray that here today in Jesus' name. Amen. I would like to spend the next a little bit, in fact, perhaps the rest of this lesson on this overview of the book of Acts, and to talk about the man that wrote the book of Acts. And we do believe that, or we know that with a certainty, that the book of Acts was written by Luke, who, whenever Paul writes the letter to the Colossians in Colossians chapter 4 and verse 14, he identifies him there as a physician. And for much of the book of Acts, once you start reading toward the latter part, around chapter 16 or so, you start seeing the evidence that Luke actually traveled with Paul. I think that escapes us sometimes, or it certainly did me, that I always read when I was reading through the book of Acts. You obviously read of Paul and Barnabas and John Mark, and then later on Paul and Silas, various other places where that even Timothy traveled with him. But Luke is almost a character that is sort of behind the scenes. It really does not enter your mind a whole lot that he is there through some of the troubles and the difficulties. And I would not even be surprised, and certainly he does not make reference to this, but some of the persecution and endurance of the things, difficult things that Paul had to go through, we certainly, I don't think, would be stretching it to say that Luke perhaps was being involved in this. And yet you see a man that was writing under the inspiration of the Holy Ghost, that he never really lets that enter in to the writing. Certainly in the book of Acts, that he does not really make reference to the fact that he was in that, but there was certainly the tension, I believe, that he would feel. And I would just point out to you that Luke, even though he may not have had the necessarily the prominence or the notoriety that what Paul had, certainly he was a very valuable tool, an important cog in the apostolic movement, because his writings that he wrote down as they traveled, those would be lost to us. But the Lord determined that Luke was going to be there to write those. So Luke's work was very important. I think that certainly that we have to understand in the apostolic church that every one of us have a place that the Lord has called us to, and we need to do our diligence to have a passion about what the Lord has called us to do, and then to fit uniquely into that place and to do the will of God. Some time back, I I have to confess to you that you sometimes battle over, you know, what success is, and especially if you are a person that is concerned about the advancement of the gospel. There's times where we have a tendency to look off to various places around the country or even sometimes prominent ministers, and we feel like that perhaps because we're not involved in some of the venues that they are in, then there can be a trick or and a trap of the devil to try to make us believe that we are ineffective. And yet, whenever I look at Paul's interaction with all of these characters in the Word of God, I was really caught, I guess, off guard by this one day whenever I was just talking to the Lord in prayer about what success really looks like. And He brought my attention to the fact about how that Timothy was the pastor there in Ephesus. And if that was Ephesus was probably one of the high water marks. It was one of the larger churches that Paul would establish. But he told Timothy that he wanted him to stay in Ephesus. And then you fast forward to the book of Titus, and you see Titus is instructed by Paul that he is to go to Crete. And there's a composition of that congregation there that he really paints up well. He says that some of them are slow bellies, some of them are liars, and that there are some things that need to be set in order whenever he does get to Crete. And so we have Timothy in Ephesus, we have Titus in Crete, we've got Luke that's following around the Apostle Paul recording what is taking place in that. And then there are other characters in the book of Colossians. It speaks of a man that really has inspired me as well in times past. It was a man by the name of Epaphras. And what Paul says about Epaphras is the fact that he labored fervently for you or earnestly in prayer. What a faithful pastor that this man was, that he was willing to begin to give his life to prayer. And whenever I look at that variety of characters that I found just in those that I mentioned, and obviously there are others that we could make reference to. Onesiphorus was one of them, and various others. And you ask yourself the question, which one of those men were the most successful? Well, the American look at it would probably say that Timothy was, because he was at the largest place. He was at the church that really, I'm sure, every young minister probably perhaps wondered what it would be like to be in that place. But it came to me that the person that is doing the will of God, no matter where they are, if they are effectively serving the Lord in their calling where they're at, then they are certainly successful in the kingdom of God. And it's important for us with our Western culture that we are not blinded sometimes by the ideas and concepts that success and what it really entails, that whenever you look, as we said in the last lesson, about how the character is crucial. If there is a character that you have in your heart and that the Holy Ghost has really worked to help you to become what you need to be, then I certainly believe that that is what we should strive for, and no matter where the Lord has placed us, that we are to be servants of the Lord. And so Luke, very important. There's another fact that we need to consider, that if he was a physician, you wonder what kind of steady income that he would have had. I do know that there are some scholars that feel like that Luke perhaps was even a slave, but because of his medical abilities, I certainly and would be led to believe that it would have been a way for him to make a fairly decent living during his time. But he was willing to walk away from that job, I guess, and was able to fulfill the will of God. And so again, those matters play into the fact that whenever the Lord calls us, that we have to do what the Lord would have us to do. Now, whenever you look at the book of Acts, there are some key individuals that he mentions, and he mentions it in the dedication both of Luke and of Acts. He says that he is writing to Theophilus. And he mentions in Acts chapter 1, and you've read it there, Acts chapter 1, verse 1, "The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and to teach." And so this man here is a reference that we find. We'll talk about him a little bit later on in the lesson. But something else that you will notice about comparison between the book of Luke and also the book of Acts, and that's this, is that there is a very similar writing style that you find. There are certain words and phrases that are common to both of those books and the way that they are arranged. And interestingly enough, I have a medical background, so this has always been something that I have found interested in, that Luke uses some medical terms that none of the other writers of the New Testament used. There was a specificity that he had whenever he began to write that. And I do believe that whenever we're working for the Lord, that the Lord, under the unction of the Holy Ghost, will use our gifts, our callings, our abilities to fit into that category where that is going to be suitable to serve him. And then whenever we get to, here's another point that I would suggest to you, is that whenever we get to places like Acts chapter 16 and in Acts chapter 20, Acts 16 and 10 and Acts chapter 20 and verse number 6, there's a word that's inserted there that kind of tips us off to the fact that Luke is there with him, and that's the presence and the evidence of the word "we." And it's important that we realize that from Acts 16, pretty well onward, that there were a lot of times where that Luke was very intricately attached to the life of Paul. We notice there that he is in the, when they went from Troas to Philippi, starting in Acts chapter 16, that Luke is there. In the second missionary journey, we again discover that Luke there is from Philippi back to Jerusalem, where he was with Paul. That's in Acts chapter 20 and verses 5 through 15, and then in Acts chapter 21, verses 1 through 18. And then lastly, we know that Paul, whenever he went to Jerusalem, back to Rome in Acts 27, all the way through Acts 28:16, that Luke was present with Paul. And so therefore, we have to know that Luke was a very key member on the team that Paul was working. And then when you look outside of Scripture and you start looking into some of the early church fathers, there's one specifically, a man by the name of Irenaeus, and he was one of the second century writers, and he made reference to the fact that Luke was indeed the author of the book of Acts. And again, I won't go back into it from our last lesson, but it's certainly important for us in the 21st century that whenever we begin to look at the Word of the Lord, that we have great confidence in knowing about the integrity and the inerrancy and the inspiration of the Word of God. We have this book in our hands that literally is God-breathed, and therefore it gives confidence to us. Now, I did mention that whenever you look in the book of Acts, that some of these dates can be a little fluid. If you have a variety of study Bibles that you may rely on, sometimes a Thompson Chain reference, a Schofield, a English, or an ESV, the English Standard Version, or even a New American Standard, or even a New King James. If they are study Bibles, sometimes you'll notice a little bit of a difference between the dates there. I do think that we need not let that alarm us, that there may be some overlap, and some scholars may feel like, but what we're seeing is that the general date, we can all look at at that, and they're all pretty much in agreement as to around about the same time. So I would look to here in the book of Acts that the date of Acts can somewhere be established. It was written around AD 63 from Rome there. That would be about the end of a two-year imprisonment that Paul was under house arrest there in Rome, and he stopped short of telling us about the death of Paul, although it's clear that whenever you read Paul's last letter, 2 Timothy, that he gets to 2 Timothy chapter 4, and in verse number 6 and in verse number 11, we also can see that Luke was present with Paul there to the end of his life. And so we know that AD 63 would probably be a good date to kind of pinpoint as to when that book was written. And I'm sure obviously that Luke had gathered some notes and perhaps even had a travel journal that he had written as he was involved in there. Now let's talk for a moment about that date of AD 63. What we find whenever we see that last chapter in the book of Acts, in fact, I'm going to read that last verse in Acts chapter 28 to you. You can see that there is a very abrupt ending that Luke writes there. We see this, and I'll start in verse number 30 to kind of give you an idea of the context of it. It says, "And Paul dwelt two whole years in his own hired house and received all them that came in unto him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching those things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ, and with all confidence, no man forbidding him." And then the book ends. It just kind of abruptly stops. And so we know that there were some certainly events. We've mentioned that Paul would be executed there at the chopping block, and it's important that we understand that it kind of ends on a high note. It says that he's preaching and he's teaching, and that there was no man that was forbidding him, and that is important for us to know, because when you look at world history and you dovetail it in, there would be an emperor, Caesar, that would come along, and his name was Nero. And Nero was he was an animal whenever he was turned loose on the early church. You can read some of those events in the Fox's Book of Martyrs. There are historical events that he describes there. And you can just begin to look that Nero was not friendly to those believers in Christianity there in Rome. It would be difficult to understand that if Luke had witnessed the persecution of the saints by Nero and even the execution of Paul, that he would have written those into the book of Acts. And so we look at that AD 63 as a date, as kind of a stopping off point. And I certainly believe that Luke probably was alive and did see all of these things to take place, but he does not give a hint of that whenever he is writing the book of Luke. Another thing that we can look at is that it appears that up to that point that the Roman officials, even though there was scurrying an amount of persecution in a variety of places, some of that came from the Judaizers, some of that came from other officials in other countries, but it would appear that the Romans were not really totally necessarily a hardline opposition to the spread of Christianity as they would become later on. Certainly Nero, and then Later on, you know, in AD 70, that the fall of Jerusalem took place, and there was another man that was involved in that. His name was Titus. And then later on, about 30 years or so after that, whenever John, the apostle, the only one of the apostles that is still alive at that point, is sent to the island of Patmos, he is sent there by a man by the name of a man whose name is Domitian. And so certainly in these early stages here, some of the persecution was not raining down on the church like it would in a little bit later time. There are other things that you can look at, some of the doctrinal and theological concerns of the years that took place past AD 70. Those are not mentioned. And Luke details, he does detail some of the things. Whenever we get to Acts 15, we'll be able to see how they dealt with the Judaizers that really wanted to squeeze in and put the Mosaic law back on these early believers there in the church. And then as we look at that if there was an opportunity for Paul to travel after he was released from prison, or after his second imprisonment, or if Luke even has some travels after the death of Paul, Luke does not write these in to the book of Acts. And so that would tell us that that somewhere around AD 63 would be a good date for us to look at where the book of Acts was written. And even though that Luke was a Gentile, there are certainly a familiarity that he had with the way that Jewish society functioned and the way that it flowed. He would have been able to understand about their laws and about the composition of their government, and about how that it worked. He had been exposed to their history and their customs and their festivals. And so whenever he starts writing in his books, not only Acts, but also in the book of Luke, that there are elements of understanding that Luke would have accordingly. He had a very personal knowledge of Nazareth concerning its hill and its synagogue. He would have known about Capernaum and the centurion that built the synagogue there. He would have been able to know what Jerusalem was like with the nearby Mount of Olives, and about the synagogue that was there, and about the temple with its courts and its gates and its porticos, and even he describes that some of the porches that he knows about as he talks about. We start looking at places like Emmaus and Lydia and Joppa and Caesarea, other towns that would have been known to him, because all of those locations make their way into his gospel and to the details of the book of Acts whenever he is writing there. And so whenever you start reading even the early chapters in the book of Luke, you find out that there is a familiarity that Luke, he would have been able to spend some time with Mary. Perhaps she was at that point middle-aged, even an aged woman during that time. And Luke was able to spend time and to hear her speak about the annunciation that the angel brought to her. And he would talk to her about what it was like for Elizabeth and John the Baptist and for those settings. And then the details of the ascension, the day of Pentecost, the early preaching of the gospel, the opposition of the Sanhedrin, and even eyewitness accounts of what Stephen endured during his martyrdom, perhaps even the conversion of Cornelius. And then he picks up sometime after that, and that he literally is a man that is traveling about in that part. Now, some have wondered, well, who was Theophilus? Well, whenever you start looking at some of that, we know that his identity, there are some speculations about who that Theophilus was. We don't know with a certainty, but here are some ideas that I would like to interject to you just for some consideration, just out of a personal area of interest that you can dig out for yourself if you choose to look to further commentaries in the book of Acts. But some believe that he was a lawyer and that he was working to free Paul and to represent him there in the court of the Romans. We don't know that, but there have been those that have speculated and said that he very well could have been a lawyer. There are others that think that he was a government official, a Roman official that was sympathetic to the cause of Christianity and to the cause of Paul. And then there's others that feel like that Luke was writing to him as a government official, and what Luke was doing is Luke was writing his letters to him as an evangelistic tool to be explained to him the history and to say, look, we want you to be a convert to Christianity. There are some very imaginative scholars, and this is a little bit of a stretch, but they believe that Theophilus was a patient of Luke's and that he was actually under the care of Luke, as Luke is a physician, and was actually under his care. And in those days, there were slaves. Some have held that Luke was actually a slave and that Theophilus very well could have owned Luke, and it was because of his medical skills and devotions that Theophilus had been saved from death. And so therefore, because he was grateful for Luke's intervention and helping him to get well, that they feel like that he very well could have granted Luke freedom to be able to go about and to travel. And then there's others that think that he was just an anonymous person, and they say it was just a general term, because when you look at his name, you find that it's where they connect two Greek words, theos and philein, which basically means to love. And so therefore, he was a lover of God. And so they would say, well, Luke was just writing an anonymous letter to those that were saying, hey, I love God and you love God. We want to tell you what's going on here in the church. And yet, whenever we see where Luke was writing to this man by the name of Theophilus, he proved to be a very powerful contribution to the kingdom of God. There are no miracles, signs, wonders, great evangelistic opportunities that are ever ascribed to Theophilus. And yet the fact is the same holds true for Luke. We don't know a lot about whether Luke was involved in these. And yet it hones in on the fact that we realize that every person has their place in the kingdom of God. And I'm drawn into the fact that whenever there was a couple of parables that Jesus told about some men that were given some talents, and one was given one, another was given two, and another was given five. Obviously, the man that went out had one talent, went out and buried his, hid it away, and then the man that had the two talents, he went and invested his, and the Lord, by his investments, those talents grew. And then obviously the five talent man, that he very much had success with his. I like the fact that the Lord included the man that had two talents, because what does that tell me? I just look at that as, and perhaps some of this is just as a fertile and I hope a godly imagination, to be able to say that even in the kingdom of God, that there are average men and women, that they may not be five talented individuals, but they're two talented individuals. And what they do is they invest the talents that the Lord has given them. And while some would look and say, well, the return on their talents has not been, you know, as much as what the five talent individual has, there is still a very important contribution that this person made to the kingdom of God. It's unfortunate that we sometimes turn the kingdom of God into a hierarchy. Every person that is a Holy Ghost filled believer, they have great value to the kingdom of God. And it's only going to be whenever we get to judgment. I have a feeling fact, one of my instructors and a great man of God, Brother Kelsey Griffin, used to really encourage us to keep in mind that one of these days there is going to be a judgment that we are going to stand before the Lord, and we're going to have to give an accounting of what the Lord has given to us. And those, so therefore, it's crucial on our parts for us to come along and say we must do the will of God, whether it's an involvement in what we may see as a very small part. The fact is that we do need to be involved in the kingdom of God. And there's a responsibility that we have to do the will of God. And certainly I believe that should enter in to our prayers. And I find myself praying that a lot, that Lord, help me to do your will. The will of one, I believe that as the Lord fills us with the Holy Ghost, that we are sent into a variety of areas, and that there is something uniquely important about your life. And I just pray today that somehow that I can just drive that point home to you and tell you that you're important in the kingdom of God. And don't let the fiery darts of the devil be cast in your direction where that he would lodge something in your mind full of doubt, and that he would make you feel like you're a second-rate citizen in the kingdom of God. If God has called you, do the very best that you can do at what the Lord has called you to do. Now let's take a look. We've looked at Luke as the author of the book of Acts, and then we have addressed the fact about who he wrote that to, Theophilus. Now let's just kind of talk about some of the people. We did mention yesterday in the outline of the book of Acts about how that Peter was very prominent in the first 13 chapters of the book of Acts, and then it sort of moves beyond that, and then you begin to see the last half of the book of Acts that is primarily dealing with Paul and his travels about. And so certainly Peter is important there, and Paul is very important there, but there were others that were involved just as well. James. And whenever we get to that part in Acts chapter 12 where that James is beheaded, again, he was a very important member of that early apostolic church. But it plays in again to the theology of suffering, that you look at what Peter and John, and then Peter from the jailbreak, various other times. Whenever you look throughout the book of Acts, there are miraculous times where that the Lord helped them to escape, and yet he could have delivered James, but the Bible tells us that he does not deliver James. He did not deliver Stephen from his stoning. And so again, that plays into the fact that there is a theology of suffering that is woven into that. And again, when you look at these men, they're lessons for us to be able to see how God functions sometimes in his grace and in his power. And again, even though that James and Stephen lost their lives as martyrs, what does that do? I believe that should cause us to understand that this material world that we live in, that we are around every day, that we should not be so drawn in to think or to say that this is all there is to life. There is a heavenly home that is waiting for us, and we need to expend our lives some said it like this, your time, your treasure, and your talent, that you should extend that and invest that in the kingdom of God, because certainly one of these days, I would just tell you as brothers and sisters in the Lord, that the most important thing that you do in this world is what we do for the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we see that here. We also see the mention of John. He's one of the companions of Peter there. I'd like to just note something to you out of a book that I have greatly enjoyed and have had a lot of just beneficial things added to me as far as a student of the Word of God, and that is the Preacher's Outline and Study Bible. And here is what it speaks of. It talks about how that Acts is the triumphant faith. It says that whenever you look at the picture of Acts, it is far different from the picture of the disciples whenever they felt that defeat over the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. You look back, that there was great sorrow that they had in their lives, and no doubt those 3 days while they were, I'm sure they had given up, Peter going back to his nets, going back to his old life, that there certainly was cause for great discouragement and perhaps even depression whenever the Lord had died. But yet his resurrection and them seeing him step out of that tomb and overcome death, that it was something transformed those men and women in the book of Acts. And so whenever you look at that, there's uncertainty, there's apprehension, and there is powerlessness that they all manifest and demonstrate prior to the resurrection. And even some of that, you look, is even in Acts chapter 1. There's a fearfulness. You remember whenever they are there, they see the ascension of Jesus, and then there comes that question to them. It's in Acts chapter 1 and verse number 11. Well, let's start in verse 10. And while they looked steadfastly toward heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus which is taken from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven." And then there was that 10-day waiting period. There was that tarrying process. And we'll obviously get into that as we unfold the book of Acts. But here is what I would tell you, that I'm certain that even at that when they saw the Lord ascend up into heaven, that there was a question about, well, what do we do now? But something's going to take place in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 2. The Bible tells us there, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now let's pair up for a moment what Jesus had said to them in Acts chapter 1. And verse number 8, you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. And when he had spoken these things, while they beheld him, he was taken up, and a cloud received him out of their sight. And then they were gloriously baptized 10 days later with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. So there was certainly a power that came in to their lives. Now let's move forward from Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2. And I would like to read to you out of Galatians chapter 2. Here is what Paul has to say, okay? We're talking about that powerful event that took place in their life. What happened there? Paul sums it up like this in Galatians chapter 2 and verse number 20. He said, "I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me." What was Paul speaking about? He was saying that this crucified Savior, this crucified Christ, that by the investment of that Spirit that He had in Him now helps me to live a very crucified life. And then certainly, if you remember what Paul wrote to the church at Rome in Romans chapter 11, a very, very important chapter for us to know. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and of death. And so you begin to realize, and I won't read all of that chapter, but Romans chapter 8 is a very powerful chapter for us as Pentecostals and apostolic believers to know that there is a resident power and anointing of the Holy Ghost that came on us. And so therefore, the book of Acts is a very, it tells us about the triumphant faith. So when this Spirit was invested in them, what happens? Well, there's courage to stand before crowds and fearlessly began to proclaim the very message that they had previously been hunted down and persecuted. And they're standing up and they're saying, you know what? There is an authority and a liberty that we feel by the power and the virtue of the Holy Ghost that has come into us. And then we see something else. There is an unwavering boldness to face authorities and even imprisonment for the cause of their faith. You see that in Acts chapter 4, verses 1 through 4. You find that in Acts chapter 5, verses 17 and 18. And then you see in Acts chapter 5, which is a very, I hear people say sometimes, oh, if we could just get back to the first century church. Well, it doesn't take me very long to read through. You know, again, I mentioned in the previous lesson that sometimes we read the book of Acts in a very, with a very romantic view about the way that we look at it. But whenever you say, well, I want what that first century church had. Well, I have a question for you. Do you want this? Let's think about this. The Bible says in Acts chapter 5 and verse number 1, but a certain man named Ananias with Sapphira his wife sold a possession and kept back part of the price, his wife also being privy to it, and brought it and brought a certain part and laid it at the apostles' feet. But Peter said, Ananias, why has Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and to keep back part of the price of the land? Whilst it remained, was it not your own? And after it was sold, was it not in your own power? Why have you conceived this thing in your heart? You have not lied unto men, but unto God. And Ananias, hearing these words, fell down and gave up the ghost, and great fear came on all them that heard these things. And the young men arose and wound him up and carried him out and buried him. And it was about the space of 3 hours after when his wife, not knowing what was done, came in. And Peter answered unto her, tell me whether you have sold the land for so much. And she said, yea, for so much. And then Peter said unto her, how is it that you have agreed together to tempt the Spirit of the Lord? Behold, the feet of them which have buried your husband are at the door, and they shall carry you out. And then she fell down straightway at his feet and yielded up the ghost. And the young men came in and found her dead, and carrying her forth, buried her with by her husband. And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things. And so you hear people say sometimes, oh, we want that first century power to take place in our church. I would tell you this, it's a very fearful thing to have the presence of the Spirit of God in the church as they did in that very first century. So we see that there was an authority they had to execute spiritual justice. And then you start seeing In Acts chapter 7 and verse number 54, a very triumphant faith to suffer martyrdom. But yet, here is the challenge of that. We know that Stephen, even though Paul had not written the letter to the Galatians yet, whenever he was talking about being crucified with Christ, it is remarkable to me how that Stephen would say, Lord, don't lay this sin to their charge. Don't remember them for this particular event. They're doing this in ignorance. Who does that sound like? That sounds like one of the cries, one of the seven cries that the Lord had from the cross. But I would tell you this here today. That kind of power that they had back in the first century, it energizes us even in the 21st century. And I would tell, there's a price tag on it. And please hear me out, modern day apostolic believer. Don't be afraid to pay the price and to move into the deeper life, because there are things that God can do that He will challenge and He will help and He will assist you as you go about to do the will of God. Will there be attacks? Certainly there will be. We're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but there's principalities and powers and spiritual wickedness in high places that comes against us. But if there's something that's burning in our heart that has been deposited there by the Holy Ghost, whenever you get a mix of the Holy Ghost and you have this word that begins to mingle in your heart, I'll tell you what it does. It does something to your mind that Paul urged the church in Rome to do. Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, that our mind, that there needs to be a renewal that would take place in our minds so that we would not be conformed to this world. And so the book of Acts does speak indeed of a triumph of faith. And then I would tell you in Acts chapter 27 and verse number 27, here's what Paul would say. He said, wherefore, sirs, he said, be of good cheer. He said, for I believe God that it shall be even as it was told me. There is a confidence that Paul had in God in knowing that the Lord had spoken to him. So wherever you're at, you may be involved in a local church somewhere. I don't know. You may be a missionary that is all the way across the globe. You may be not an American. You may be another people group that you may be thousands of miles away, and yet here is what I know. I know this, that God speaks to us and helps us to be able to advance His cause. And so we start looking again. I would mention just a few more names quickly here before we conclude this lesson, but there's a supporting cast that you find in the book of Acts, and we're going to find them as this book progresses in this Bible study. We're going to see that there are stalwarts of the faith, but at the same time, you're going to see some of the most, if I could use this term, some of the most nasty, nefarious characters that we're going to run across, that you're going to find them in the book of Acts. They're villains. They're vagabonds. They're people that you say, I don't want to be near them because there's something very sinister about who they are and what they're trying to do. And we're going to find some of those. You're going to find common people. You're going to find those that come from the highest level of society. One of our great men of God in the organization that I'm involved in has used this term before. He said that God can save from the uttermost, and that's the way up, or He can save to the guttermost. It does not matter. You find a wide array of people that God is able to use. So we're going to run across a lame man, a high priest, Ananias and Sapphira, Gamaliel, Simon the sorcerer, Aeneas, Dorcas, Cornelius, Stephen, Philip, Festus, Felix, Agrippa, Drusilla. There's others that we're going to run across. You have to you start that Festus, Felix, and Agrippa. I preached a message years ago about three fatal mistakes, and all three of those men made some fatal mistakes in their walk. One of them said, "You know what, Paul? Much learning has made you mad. I'm not even interested at all." There was another man that his mistake 8 was this: come back and talk to me whenever I have a more convenient season. And then Agrippa's mistake was this: almost you persuade me. And we find that same kind of reaction to people that we witness to. We find people that say, y'all are so radical and your church is so weird and odd in the way that you do things, and we don't want anything to do with that. Don't be concerned with the rejection of that. Paul had to endure that. You find others that they're intrigued. The Holy Ghost convicts them and starts trying to draw them in. And in their mind, they're saying, oh, I love what I feel here. I feel the liberty and the strength of the Holy Ghost. And I do want to change, but call me at a more convenient time in my life. And then obviously Agrippa, there are others that you run into and you say, almost. I'm almost there with you. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm almost there. And so we're going to meet some of these characters here. And then lastly, I just want to kind of briefly touch the book of Acts is primarily historical in nature. What that means is that it's a narrative. It tells a story. And you start reading the book of Acts. There is an unfolding. It's almost like you're reading a novel. And yet, whenever we look at that, I would say that it's probably the first and the greatest volume of church history. But yet what I also notice is that whenever Luke is writing and he bumps into various things, there are hints of doctrine that we begin to see here. Some of the doctrines that we find there is the doctrine of Jesus Christ. We'll see some evidence of Christology. That's what the doctrine of Jesus Christ is called. It's Christology. We'll find about the incarnation, about the death and the resurrection and the ascension. I would point out to you that if you read ahead and you start looking at the book of Acts, the book of Acts was also a volume of preaching. In fact, somewhere around 1/4 of the book of Acts, you'll find if you scatter this, if you look at this, taking all of the verses, about every fourth verse, 25% of the book of Acts is going to be dealing with preaching. Apostolic preaching is very important. And so woven in, you're going to find the incarnation and the death, the burial and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ in His ascension. We'll find the doctrine of the Spirit. There's a term that they use to describe that. That's called pneumatology. And what we see there, we see the operation of the gifts of the Spirit. We see revelation. We see discernment. We see miracles, signs, and wonders. We see active work, the active work of the Holy Ghost as it strengthens believers to walk as they're justified, as they're sanctified in their walk in holiness in that. We're also going to see the doctrine of salvation. The way that you would describe that is a word called soteriology. That's just salvation. We see the new birth there, which includes repentance, water baptism, by immersion in Jesus' name, the infilling of the Spirit, and all of these areas. And then I mentioned with the doctrine previously about justification, sanctification, which is holiness, and then even glorification, which is going to be the future state of the believer, of the saint of God. And then we find the doctrine of the church. That term can be called ecclesiology. That is just the beginning of the church. We even see the element of church government that's involved there. We see the role of deacons and elders and pastors. We see general ministry. Here's one that we find, again, I mentioned to you just a few minutes ago. People say, well, we want the first century church. We want to experience what they experienced in the past. Well, you saw where Ananias and Sapphira fell over in Acts chapter 5, but there's something else that you find woven in to that early church, and that's church discipline. That's something that we never, hardly ever see worked out in our local churches. And yet a prime example of that is 1 Corinthians chapter 5, where that Paul, he was very much incensed. He said, it's commonly reported that there's fornication that's existing here in this church. And he dealt with it. And he dealt with it in a way that is articulated by the Word of God. And so we ask ourselves the question to the American church, is church discipline something that should be going on? I believe that it is. I believe that this is not just a collection of a country club of sorts, a social club that we're gathering together. If we're truly going to be apostolic, a church is made up of four types of people. It's made up of shepherds, it's made up of sheep, it's made up of goats, and it's made up of wolves. Here's what you do with those four groups. Encourage the shepherds to the best of your ability. And then obviously we need to take the advice from the Lord, and we need to feed the sheep. And then the third category are the goats. And please, whatever you do, don't entertain the goats. Ignore the goats. Do the best you can do with the goats, but just leave them to their own folly. And then the Bible tells us that wolves. What do we do with wolves? You better kill a wolf if that wolf gets in to an apostolic congregation. And I believe that primarily wolves come to us in forms of false teachers. And it is crucial for us to be able to know the Word of the Lord in such a powerful way that we can deal with false teachers and false doctrine and error that even has a way of encroaching into the apostolic church in our time. And so I'm going to expand on some of these, and I pray that again, that this is going to be a blessing and an encouragement to you here in the next coming weeks and days and weeks and even perhaps months as we go through the book of Acts. I'd like to conclude with a word of prayer and just ask the Lord to help us to some of these things that have been dropped out here. And I would tell you again, no, this is nothing on me. I'm certainly not the greatest preacher or teacher in the world, but again, I'll tell you like I did in the last lesson. I have so much confidence in the Word of the Lord and that the anointed Word of God, that it can have an incredible impact on our lives. And so I would just pray here that as the seed finds its place in your heart, that there would be a growth that would take place. Let's conclude here in prayer tonight. Lord, I am ever again so thankful for your goodness, Lord, not only in my life, but to everyone of us. And I pray, Lord, that as your word says, that we would desire the sincere milk of the word. And Lord, not only that, but we want this word to be engrafted into our hearts and into our minds in such a way that, Lord, that you're going to be able to change us and help us, Lord, to do your will. I don't want that to be a redundant prayer, but I want it to be an active prayer, Lord, that somehow that we know that wherever we're at, whatever place that our geography finds us, that we can indeed do your will and have great service to your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. And I would just pray for you again. The Lord bless you. And my time is up, and I am certainly thankful for yours and appreciate your involvement in this. The Lord bless you.